I could talk to you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry about everything. I just wish I could talk to someone. It's all falling apart here. I can't believe what's happening. Strange. Such a little thing.
That's her? Nicole?
Yeah. First deferred from her in weeks.
We're 5 minutes out, you still got that thing on repeat? Guess you really miss her.
This humor is not a job you turn down, but 6 months apart with only vid calls? It's rough. Easy to say the wrong thing.
I don't blame you. I'd listen to my girlfriend over Hammond reciting security protocols.
Forewarned is forearmed, Miss Daniels.
So you keep saying...
Here we go. Nice clean re-entry. Welcome to Aegis 7.
Imagine 6 months staring at that chunk of rock.
To an independent miner, that's paradise. Aegis 7 is one of the richest finds in CEC history. Some prospecting team set up for life. Now, where is she?
There. Confirming visual contact with USG Ishimura.
What a beauty. Biggest planet cracker in her class, you know. And it looks like they already popped the cork.
Why is it so dark? We should be able to see her running lights.
Yeah. I'll get us into hailing range. Someone's got to be waiting up for us.
Just be careful on the approach. I'm not taking any chances with the CEC's pride and joy.
No chances, huh? Is that why you were digging into my personnel files before we left?
You track your file access?
I'm a computer analyst. Comes with the job.
I ran standard CEC background checks, Miss Daniels. If you want to work in the big leagues, you have to play ball.
Sir, we're in hailing range. USG Ishimura, this is the emergency maintenance team of the USG Kelly responding to your distress call. Come in, Ishimura. Ishimura, do you copy? Come in. This is the USG Kelly.
You ever hear of a full communications blackout on one of these things?
Never. Come on. Someone picked up the damn phone.
The hell is that?
Sounds like their communication array is busted. Maybe a broken encoder. Daniels and I can handle it in 48 hours, max.
Hey, that gives you plenty of time to catch up with Nicole.
Yeah, I hope so.
Jen, Johnson, take us in.
Gravity tethers engaged. Automated docking. Let's go.
We're losing control.
Fuck! We're off course!
Daniel!
Guidance system override isn't responsive.
Shit, we're coming in too high. It's gonna smash us into the hull.
Jet, aim for that emergency stabilizer. There, the blue light. It might slow us down.
Guys,
drop the blast shield. Everyone brace yourself.
Better than a broken neck. Or worse. Good call on the stabilizer, Isaac.
Gotta always read the manual.
What the fuck's going on with flight control? That guidance system's a death trap.
Better add it to your repair list. Jen, what's our damage?
Comms are down. We lost a port booster. Got a fire in one of the stabilizers and... Singularity core's a mess. Could be worse, but not by much.
Then let's get some help. Johnston, stay with the Kelly. We'll send a medic. Everyone else, with me.
Stand clear.
Crap, we came down hard.
Not a great start to our repair mission.
Pulse rifles?
Standard procedure, Miss Daniels. We'll register them in the flight lounge.
Hello?
Where is everybody? Half the ship must have heard that landing.
Be proud, Chen. You got us here in one piece.
Ch-
Johnson might disagree. But you're off to buy the first round.
I wouldn't mind something to steady my nerves, especially on CEC staff.
You see anyone in flight control?
No, nobody.
At least we didn't take out the sign.
With 34 to date and highest dead weight of refined product at 14 trillion kilotons and counting. Whether you'll be joining us aboard the Ishimura or strengthening the extraction workforce on
the may as well get signed in. Isaac, come sink your rig.
Welcome, Isaac Clark, to the USG Ishimura. Rig synced. Collect kinesis and stasis modules from Acting Chief Engineer Jacob Temple. Location? Error. Employee not found.
I can't read security.
Same for the Chief Engineer. What is wrong with their comms?
Someone left in a hurry.
Where's the security detail? Where's anybody?
There's nothing logged. No duty roster, no power to the elevator.
For God's sake. That security console's still working. Isaac, get a damage report. I'm done playing around.
There's something on the floor here. Is that?
Isaac, I need that damage report.
Oh, God, that smell.
What have you got, Isaac?
Shit. It's not just comms or the guidance system. Half the Ishimura's in the red. Engines, hull, the trams.
You could do that kind of damage to a planet cracker.
Okay, out of some power. Ventilation's up. Power to the elevator should be...
Hazardous anomaly detected. Quarantine activated.
Another malfunction?
No. The quarantine systems are all fine.
Oh, wait. Do you hear that?
Yeah. Yeah, I hear it.
Hammond?
Take it easy. Daniels, get those elevators on.
There's something in here.
Up there!
Oh, God!
Doors open!
Get out of there!
Kendra, the door!
Hey everybody, it's JTB, and welcome to my no damage run for Impossible Mode in the Dead Space remake. A few people mentioned on the original walkthrough they were kind of disappointed there was no commentary. The reason for that run was to kind of start putting together, you know, the no damage run. I really want to see the kind of viability of doing no save, no damage for the entire run. That's why certain chapters in this are no save and some of them aren't. I'm going to try and get as many as I can. Right off the bat though, Chapter 4 has one of the worst segments in it for no damage, and it's the asteroid segment. I really need to dig into that a bit more, you know, to find a way that's 100% reliable, as it's quite deep into the run. But anyway, to kind of get some things out of the way with this, early on in the game, you're by far your weakest in Chapter 1, because you don't have stasis for a, you know, minor part of it, but mainly you don't have kinesis. This is a remake of Dead Space 1, obviously, but it does play quite significantly, quite differently. I think the easiest way to describe this game is more a Dead Space 2 mod for Dead Space 1, because it essentially just has Dead Space 2's gameplay, you know, but in kind of the Dead Space 1 game. And due to that, you get a lot of buffs. The main one being, I think, is just how kinesis works. I'll go over kinesis when we get to some encounters to kind of just describe, you know, a few key things in why it is just so powerful in the game. So I'll be using that a lot. You'll see me use stasis a lot as well. Stasis does feel a little bit weaker in this compared to the first one, and that's mainly just on time. I haven't tested it side by side, but you know, even just your default stasis in Dead Space 1 lasts a very, very, very long time. And I think it lasts a little bit shorter in this. It's not quite as quick as Dead Space 2's, but it's definitely not as long as the first game. If I could be remembering that completely wrong, but someone let me know. If it is the same, then I'm just misremembering. So at this point, I'm just going to pop in a quick save here, because I just wanted a save to kind of practice Chapter 1. But I actually got this straight away, so I thought, well, you know, I'm just going to carry on. I'm not going to redo the intro. One little kind of pet peeve of the game is that you can't skip the intro. This game's intro is incredibly long. I really wish it would just kind of put you right at the bit where you get the plasma cutter. I feel like that's kind of where the game properly starts, and you could just take it from there. But, you know, it's a minor thing, really. All you got to do is make one save, and then you can, you know, play to your heart's content. So weapon-wise, you'll see me kind of stick to a similar loadout as I did in the kind of relaxed walkthrough. That walkthrough was pretty clean overall, but there's a few things in it that I wanted to tidy up, you know, for the no damage run. Mainly just planning things out. I didn't really do much in the way of side missions either on that run, as I actually didn't really know they were a thing for the most part. I only really found out that, you know, after completing it a couple of times. On this run, I am going to be doing those as just to kind of serve as more of a complete run, so to speak, and what you actually get from doing those side missions is very, very powerful. You get the full stasis upgrade, you know, that just keeps enemies in place and damages them. You get a lot of weapons from doing all the side stuff. You know, well, you don't get weapons, but you get a lot of weapon upgrades from doing a lot of the side stuff, so they're definitely worth doing. If you skip all that stuff, you will actually find yourself probably about only halfway through the weapon upgrades, and the weapons in this game are pretty insane. And going back to what I was saying about the remake and the original, the weapons in this game have all been retooled quite significantly. So the plasma cutter is pretty much the same. However, the rotation on the alt fire is slower, and the biggest change that you will notice in this chapter, at least when I first started playing, is it's not necessarily the removal of staggers, but the stagger system works way differently in this game. I won't swear to knowing exactly how it works yet, but it definitely does seem to be tied to the amount of damage you deal to enemies instead of the amount of hits you deal to enemies. So if you've played the original in any, you know, great depth, you'll be pretty familiar with how stagger works in the original. You know, shoot an enemy in the arm, head, or leg, and they'll get knocked back quite significantly. They don't tend to run through your shots as much. In this, they can just kind of tank your shots and armor through it and just keep on trucking and coming at you. So you really want to embrace that early on and know how to counter it. The main way in countering that is obviously taking off a leg is still one of the most, you know, the simplest ways to do it. Using stasis here, any fights that give you a stasis pack, you know, in them, there really is no point not using them, you know, especially if you're going for a run like this. Really abuse stasis because it just makes it really, really easy to take off their arms. The reason you'll see me go for the arms early on is because if you take off both enemy arms, then that enemy will just die. They can't attack you without arms, for, you know, these regular necromorphs, so I feel like that's just the game's way of kind of balancing it. And it also saves you ammo, too. Melee is really good for the most part, but you have to pick your moments. For example, you know, when enemies are stasis. Dodging enemies, generally speaking, you just want to kind of go into their attacks, not away from them. There's quite a few enemies in this game, notably the lickers, you know, the pouncers or whatever they're called, I can't remember. The torso dudes with the tail. Their hitboxes on their tail stab is absolutely insane. There's a lot of phantom hitboxes going on in this game, so generally speaking, you want to try and dodge towards an enemy instead of away from it. But the preferred method is to just not get close to begin with. And that's where, you know, your kind of rapid delims come in. So here, as you can see, these vent blade fans that are on the floor. I already made a video about this, you know, more in depth. But I don't have Kinesis here. Otherwise, you know, I would definitely be using it. But to go over real quick why Kinesis is just so powerful in this game. If you throw a enemy blade, you know, the little claws that they have coming out of their, what used to be their arms. If you throw them at enemies, that's around half life early on, up until you get to about chapter 5 or 6. You know, that'll take off, you know, half the enemy's health. And the vent blade fans are an instant delim. So here again, you know, one-on-one, you can really abuse melee with stasis. You can just stomp. And it's disturbingly satisfying to stomp enemies in this game. So yeah, that's just a quick overview of Kinesis and all that and how it works. The general rule of thumb, you know, if you're one-on-one with an enemy when you have Kinesis, you want to try and shoot off, you know, an arm, grab that arm that you shot off, throw it back at that enemy, and then you can grab off, you know, you can pull off his other arm, throw it at another enemy, that's half life, take off an arm, pull off the spike, and rinse and repeat. It's really, really overpowered. I don't know if they're... I hope they don't change it, but it really does make the game significantly easier than the original, because you could throw spikes at enemies in Dead Space 1, but I don't remember it being anywhere near as effective, you know, as it was in Dead Space 2. You know, even on the highest modes, you know, you're taking off half life pretty much with one thing, so you don't really need to worry about that. And on that note, this is impossible mode, but impossible mode in this game, it does tell you right off the bat, but just in case anyone skipped that. Impossible mode is just hard mode with one life. As far as I can tell, there's no other differences mechanically. Item drops are the same, item locations are the same. And a range mode would be super cool in this game, actually. I would love that. So here I'm waiting. Stasis doors can still damage you if you walk into them, so that's something that you actually do want to be quite careful of. The window on going through a door is quite generous when you open it. But just, you know, keep it in mind that, you know, you don't have all day. You do need to get through the door, like, relatively quickly. So here, I'm actually just kind of burning some ammo here, for some reason. I don't know why. You can just stasis this guy, you know, and just kill him with nothing but melee. Because you have a stasis machine behind you, so... You know, even if he takes all three stasis shots, it doesn't really matter, because... He's still going to be dead. Now, the spitter guys, unfortunately, for as much as this game borrows from Dead Space 2, you can't grab the acid balls that they shoot at you and throw them back, which is one of the most satisfying things to do in Dead Space 2. I absolutely love that mechanic. I'm pretty sure you can do that in 3 as well, off the top of my head. So, bit of a shame that's not in there, but it's, you know, you're powerful enough in this game at the end of the day. You don't need anything else to make you more OP. So hoover up your items as you go. Item drops, for the most part, I think are randomized. I'm not sure, you know, what really affects money drops. Money drops definitely seem a lot less in this game, though, compared to the first game. You seem to rarely get anything over 400 credits in the remake, whereas I want to say that, you know, you got a lot more money in the first game. Money's not really going to be a concern, though, on this run. After having done the original impossible walkthrough that I did, I've got to understand that the weapon drops, the item drops a lot more. Basically, it actually behooves you to not have a whole lot in your inventory, because if you're low on ammo, or, you know, low on health, or low on stasis, then more often than not, the game will tend to drop what you do not have. So, you know, if, for example, if you're holding on to 4 med packs, you know, the game isn't going to drop health for you, because you have 4 med packs in your inventory. You know, if you're sitting on 200 plasma cutter rounds, it's not going to drop plasma cutter ammo for you, because you already have loads. And you really want to use that to your advantage, you know. Only ever keep sort of one, you know, magazine's worth of ammo, you know, in your inventory. And by magazine, I don't mean how much they hold. I mean just, you know, one of the item pickups. So that's what you'll see me do on this run. I pretty much only ever have, you know, 25 extra plasma cutter rounds, unless I know I'm going into a fight where I'm going to need them. On the subject of item drops, actually, and item manipulation, it's worth noting. That's another thing that they kind of borrowed from Dead Space 2. In Dead Space 2, when you hit an enemy corpse, or if you shoot it, they will always drop an item for you, every single time. In the original Dead Space, I'm pretty sure it didn't work that way. You know, enemies would still drop items for you, you know, quite frequently, but it wasn't a guaranteed item drop, so you always want to make sure you're hitting bodies, you know, for extra items, because when you're doing a run like this, and when you're comfortable enough to sell you know, the surplus of resources you get, which is quite a lot. It might surprise some people just how quickly you become, you know, an absolute powerhouse in this game. By the end of Chapter 3, I believe, pretty much everything I have is maxed out, you know, and I have money to spare. So it's really not that difficult to get super, super comfortable early on in the game. Here, you can really take advantage of the barrels, as hopefully it's showcasing. Enemies in this game are very, very easy to manipulate. They will basically always chase you, so you can use that to your advantage and just kind of lure them near the explosive barrels. The explosive barrels do seem somewhat nerfed compared to Dead Space 1. Their blast radius just seems a lot smaller, and it also does a lot less damage. You'll see that with a couple of enemies as well later in the game. The enemies that have the you know, the bio bombs as their arms, whatever they're called, their blast radius is only about as big as their body is in this game. Which is good in a way, because, you know, you can blow them up a lot closer to you and not worry about getting damaged. But they were also really, really good to use, you know, for an offensive tool, you know, in your favor. So it's both a nerf and a buff there, but just something to keep in mind. You don't have to be quite as far away when using those as you did in the original. Another little change here to the remake are just these power breakers, which always turn out the lights because, you know, that makes it frightening, apparently. It's funny how they always turn out the lights. So again, this guy's just going to gun straight for me, but just wait for him to attack. They always kind of snarl before they attack you. I missed my shot there, but so I'm just going to burn my stasis here. Kind of worked out, though, because if I remember rightly, I think I get both of these. Yep, there we go. Both dead. I'm a little bit further along here. I'm trying to do these commentaries a little bit closer than I do normally. Usually when I do any kind of commentated run, I'll film the entire run, you know, I'll record the whole run, and then come back and do the commentary, which I kind of realized the last time I did that, you know, what ends up happening when I do that is, you know, the commentary for the later chapters is much better than the early chapters, because I did the early chapters so long ago, I don't quite remember, you know, what I actually did. That's probably still going to happen in this run, because it's me, but, you know, won't happen as much. So here we're just going to bunch these guys up, and stasis. Really pay attention to your audio in this game. It's really useful. Playing this game with headphones is highly recommended. As you can hear where, you can quite literally hear where enemies spawn, which is nice. So we'll use one exploding barrel for him. I don't have kinesis yet, otherwise, you know, I'd just be throwing the barrels at them. So you can just kind of move them around though and just run around here. Generally speaking, you'll always be able to outrun most enemies as long as you're running in a straight line. But sometimes if you take a corner badly, or, you know, you just kind of angle a turn wrong, you know, they will catch up to you, so just keep that in mind. And you also have the super obvious, you know, horn every time an enemy spawns, which is nice. I take that back. Not every time an enemy spawns. Most times an enemy spawns. So bear that in mind. Listen out for the snarls, you know. These necromorphs love to let you know they're there, even without the audio. So here we're just going to hoover up our items. And then we're going to go in here and grab the whatever it is we need in here, whatever key item it is.
Isaac, we can't stay here.
Not a lore guy. I keep meaning to do a lore playthrough because they actually did add some pretty cool stuff in this, from what I've heard. They do quite a bit more in this game to, you know, flesh out the backstory and, you know, everything. Any Dead Space lore fanatics, you know, let me know. Let me know what's going on, because I don't really have much of an idea. So here we're just going to focus on the plasma cutter early on. They've done a much better job, I think, of staggering out upgrades in this game. In the original, it's kind of a joke, like, how quickly you can become just, you know, god tier in terms of your upgrades. It's mainly through limiting the stasis. So again, hear that guy, just wait for him to come into the bomb. Your stasis upgrades are quite a bit later on in this compared to the original. So I focus on the plasma cutter first, get my damage up, get my capacity nice and high, and then I can get my stasis later on, and then that can kind of, you know, come together, and they make a really good combo. And you get the Ripper around the same time as you get your kind of stasis fully upgraded too, which is really, really good. Not that the Ripper really needs any help, but, you know. That was funny. His dismembered arm just tanked one of those shots. That was quite interesting. I'm not going to make a point of going for every single kill in the game, but I would like, you know, I'm not going to skip kills wherever possible. I want to make sure, you know, I want to make sure Isaac, you know, does his job, clears the Ishimura for those nice, nice people in Dead Space 2 that have to come on this ship afterwards. Even though, if I remember rightly, I'm pretty sure they all get murdered by something else. Can't remember off the top of my head. Again, I'm not a Dead Space lore guy. I know the lore for Dead Space is quite layered, but I never really paid too much attention to it, to be perfectly honest. This was just one of those games that, you know, mechanically just really kind of got its hooks in me early on, and I played a whole lot, ended up playing a whole lot of it because of that. So here, this is good for people like me that have a terrible memory. As you can see, I went the wrong way, even though I have played the game quite a bit. So you can, if you start sprinting and then put your map hotkey, the map hotkey doesn't actually have a default button, by the way, which is a bit weird. I would recommend putting the map on a hotkey, because some areas are a little bit confusing. So it's good to you know, be able to just pull up the map and see where you're going. See, there's a perfect example, you know. If that guy had have just, you know, not made that noise, he would have been a lot more surprising. But he didn't, so kill him. I'm not going to refill my stasis here, I don't think, because there is a stasis station, you know, coming up for free. So, fortunately, this guy spawns quite a bit far away. Always go for a leg when they're far away like that, because generally speaking, when you're really far away from the enemies, they will tend to run at you more frequently. So just make sure that, you know, you're not doing that.
Data board reinstalled. System restart complete.
I do wish you could skip some of these. I know they're not quite cutscenes, but, you know, the bit where you're just kind of, the bit where people are just talking at you, and you're just waiting for something, do you know what I mean? I wish you could kind of, I wish there was a way for you to just hurry those along a little bit. So just coming back here to refill the stasis. Stasis packs tend to be one of the rarer things to drop in the game, in my experience. So you definitely don't get stasis as often as you get. Like, stasis is definitely dynamic, but it's nowhere near as reliable as health and ammo. You know, if you're really low on health or ammo, it's almost a certainty that within the next 2 or 3 kills, you know, the game will drop health or ammo for you. Whereas stasis, you know, you can go a few fights and it won't drop a stasis pack. So just keep that in mind. You always want to try and keep your stasis full wherever possible. And don't worry about buying stasis packs. That's something that I can be bad for, because I'm just such a hoarder. You know, I want to keep everything all the time, even when I don't really need to. You know, if you need to, if you're down on stasis and you know there's not a machine nearby, just go and buy a stasis pack. You know, I think they cost 5,000 off the top of my head, and that's only just, you know, one stack of Ripper ammo plus a few plasma cutter rounds. You know, 5 grand in this game is really not a lot of money. So always make sure you've got your stasis fully loaded. On the subject of stasis, actually, you do have a hotkey for stasis in the remake, unlike the first game. In the first game, you had to go into your inventory to use a stasis pack. In Dead Space 2, they added a hotkey where you could just hit triangle, I believe, or Y, and you would just, you know, use stasis automatically. It's one of the most, it's one of the biggest indirect buffs to stasis, I think, in the sequel. And the addition that stasis packs also stacked in your inventory. So in this game, as you'll see later on, one stasis pack takes up one space in your inventory. Whereas in Dead Space 2 and 3, they stack up to 3 stasis packs in one slot, which is really kind of insane, in my opinion. That's a bit much. Stasis is really, really strong in this game. So now this guy is just playing hide and seek for some reason, so we'll just leave him be. We'll go in here and do a bit of looting, as I love to do. Got to pick up all these items. So one thing to know, you can actually end up doing a fair bit of backtracking later, you know, in this game, in the remake. They let you kind of go around the ship as you please. You can leave lockers and that, you know, kind of for a little bit later on in the interest of getting more money. One thing that you will see me do in most of my runs, dare I say it, force gun ammo, I think, is the most expensive ammo in the game. And it's kind of, it works how the contact beam ammo exploit worked in the original, in that you can have the force gun in your inventory and just never use it, but because you have it in your inventory, and ideally you want to keep it empty, you know, you don't want to have any ammo in it, the game will drop that ammo for you, you know, quite reliably, And then you can just go and sell all of it at the shop. Force-gun ammo sells for 4 grand, I think. No, I think it's 6 grand. It's 6 grand for a full stack of force-gun ammo. So that's a huge thing when it comes to, you know, upgrading mid to late game. You know, you're just getting money left, right, and center through selling force-gun ammo. Oh, on the subject of inventory as well, now that I think about it, you do have more inventory slots in the remake. You have a default of 12, I believe that was, and I think it goes up by 4 or 6 every time you get a new suit. You don't really need to worry about suits all that much, though, in this one. I can't remember what I have at the moment, but I think, generally speaking, I usually skip the level 3 and 4 suit because, you know, I'm selling all the stuff quite frequently. I don't really need the extra item slots, and, you know, a suit offering you more protection on a no damage run is, you know, somewhat irrelevant. So you don't really need to bother with that. And it's just money you can save and, you know, buy more power nodes to upgrade things. Haley, I need you to listen. So, again, another cutscene. Poor Haley. Things are about to go very bad. I find this really weird, though. Haley, she gets killed by an explosion here, I believe. That's the implication. And yet Isaac gets exploded out of the ship. And yet, you know, he's alive. He's got that main character protection. So, that's bad news for our ship. So here's the Lickers. This is one of the most nerfed enemies in the game, in my opinion. If you look at, if you see how slow they are, in the first game, well, in every other Dead Space, those guys can just absolutely book it for you and sprint at you. And the only way to really slow them down was to shoot off one of their arms. In this game, as you can see, like they like to pounce at you a little bit more than usual, but that's very, very easy to avoid. All you have to do is really sidestep it. And then, yeah, just shoot off both their arms, and these guys are dead. So, yeah, these guys are a lot easier to deal with in the remake. They also do give you a spike to use. You can pull off their tail. Sometimes you might have to stomp on their body a little bit to kind of knock it off. Sometimes the kinesis won't always rip off the spike to throw them at, to throw at another enemy. The kinesis auto-targeting in this game does leave a little bit to be desired. It's not the best. Just under the walk-in and talk-in segment. This is a bathroom in a video game, so of course it's going to have money or health in it for us.
Even the captain? God.
Isaac, you're closer to medical. You can double back and cut through maintenance. Find the captain's body and get his rig. With his codes, we... What was that? Chen?
That's a Licker in the original game, too. If I remember right. I think it's funny how Chen at that point is just, you know, not looking so good, is he? He's not looking so human-like. But, doesn't seem to bother Hammond all that much. Spoiler alert. For later in the game. I mean, if you're watching this, I'm assuming you've already beat the game. So here we have our first shop. We're going to visit that in a second and, you know, just sell off all our excess ammo. Selling ammo really is kind of how you make up for money in this compared to the original. I just feel like in the original you have way more money just overall, but you can sell a lot of ammo in this game. And I think you're also using less of it too. Impossible mode in the original is quite a bit more difficult because, you know, the enemies have a lot more health in the original compared to this on, you know, its comparative impossible mode. So, you know, you are using less ammo in this, so you get to sell more ammo as well, and you're getting more of it anyway. So it's kind of a bit of a knock-on effect as to why I think impossible in this is just overall, like, you know, quite a bit easier than the first game. The no death, you know, stipulation is not really all that significant in my book because you know, you can save. I mean, it's super easy to save, to kind of save scum this as well. if you get into a bad situation, you can just hit, you know, quit to main menu and you're fine, really. So, you know, if you really want to, you know, get that achievement, you could follow this run, and if you somehow get into a bad spot, you can always just hit, you know, return to main menu. So here, now we can see we've got our plasma cutter, you know, fully upgraded for this point in the game. There's no more upgrades we can get at the moment. One thing I did like in this game is that they kind of stagger out the upgrades a little bit, so that's just something to keep in mind. You can't just min-max, you know, whatever weapon you want. But we've got all our damage upgrades in now, and that's one of the main things that will make, you know, this a lot more straightforward is when you're killing, you know, the faster you can kill enemies, the better, really. You know, the quicker something dies, the fewer chances it has to hit you. So this is it for chapter one. I'm just gonna, you know, go until I get to a new save point. The save points in the game are a little bit tricky in terms of doing, you know, one chapter at a time. So sometimes on some of the chapters, I will do like a small segment of the following chapter just to get to a save point, which we're gonna come up to here in a second. We're just gonna grab this health and sell it. Up until a certain point, I do keep health in my inventory just to kind of keep showing that I'm at full health, but I think around chapter 4 or so I just stopped doing that because you know, we're not getting much in the way of close calls there by that point. So here we're going to just open the tram, wait for a security officer there to go through her spiel, and we're going to grab the pulse rifle. I don't use the pulse rifle a whole lot. In the original game it wasn't the best. I haven't really used it all that much, to be honest, in this one, but we're going to pick it up and just chuck that in the shop, because pulse rifle ammo seems to take priority when you have it. The game loves dropping pulse rifle ammo for you, but it doesn't sell for as much as the plasma cutter ammo. So for my money, I think you should drop that, you know, and just stick with the plasma cutter and ripper. But that's it for chapter one, guys. I will see you in chapter two. Hope you enjoyed it. Peace.